Complications in Late Pregnancy, Part 1. We hope that the viewer learns to understand the pathophysiology, implications, diagnosis, and management of the two commonest complications in late pregnancy, hypertension and diabetes in pregnancy. In this installment, we will be focusing on the spectrum of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy, which include pregnancy-induced hypertension and pre-eclampsia. Hypertension is defined as a blood pressure reading of more than 140 millimeters of mercury systolic and more than 90 millimeters of mercury diastolic on two separate occasions at least 4 hours apart. Pre-existing hypertension is defined as hypertension in a pregnant
woman
diagnosed prior to pregnancy. Pregnancy-induced hypertension is hypertension diagnosed during pregnancy, usually more than 20 weeks gestation, in the absence of proteinuria. Preeclampsia is hypertension diagnosed during pregnancy, usually more than 20 weeks gestation, in the presence of proteinuria. The incidence of pregnancy-induced hypertension and preeclampsia averages 6 to 7% of all pregnancies. Pathophysiology involves impaired placental development, resulting in uteroplacental insufficiency and a subsequent spectrum of hypertensive disorders which may have multiple end organ involvement. Predisposing factors include prima gravida, multiple gestation pregnancies, advanced maternal age, obesity, diabetes, pre-existing hypertension, pre-existing renal disease, pre-existing autoimmune disease, previous pregnancy-induced hypertensive disorder, family history of prior pregnancy-induced hypertensive disorder. Pregnancy-induced hypertension may be subdivided into mild, moderate, and severe categories. Mild pregnancy-induced hypertension is when the blood pressure is more than 140 systolic over 90 diastolic, but less than 150 systolic over 100 diastolic. Moderate pregnancy-induced hypertension is when the blood pressure is more than 150 systolic over 100 diastolic, but less than 160 systolic over 110 diastolic. Severe pregnancy-induced hypertension is when the blood pressure is more than 160 systolic over 110 diastolic. Preeclampsia, as previously mentioned, is hypertension diagnosed during pregnancy, usually more than 20 weeks gestation, in the presence of proteinuria. Proteinuria is defined as urine protein levels of more than 0.3 grams in a 24-hour urine collection. Mild preeclampsia is when the blood pressure is less than 160 systolic over 110 diastolic. Severe preeclampsia is when the blood pressure is more than 160 systolic over 110 diastolic and the mean arterial pressure is more than 125 millimeters of mercury on two occasions or more than 140 on a single occasion. Complications of preeclampsia can be divided into maternal and fetal complications. Maternal complications include eclampsia, HELLP syndrome, coagulopathy, renal failure, hepatic failure, cardiac failure, cerebrovascular events, pulmonary edema, and placental abruption. Fetal complications include fetal growth restriction, fetal demise, and prematurity. HELLP syndrome is so called as it is a complication of severe preeclampsia with hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelets. Eclampsia is the presence of tonic-clonic seizures in a pregnant
woman
that cannot be attributed to other causes. Clinical features of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy may reflect end-organ complications. The patient may present with complaints of headache, visual disturbances such as blurring or flashes of light, abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, generalized swelling, breathing difficulties, oliguria, easy bleeding, and even fitting episodes. On examination, the patient may have features of hyperreflexia, epigastric or right hypochondrial tenderness, seizures, altered mentation, fluid overload, signs of end organ dysfunction, and cerebrovascular events. Investigations may be divided into hematological, urinary, and radiological. Hematological investigations include full blood count, clotting panel, including PT and APTT, uric acid, liver function test, and renal panel. Urinary investigations include daily urine albumin, 24-hour urine total protein, creatinine clearance test, and urine protein-creatinine ratio. Radiological investigation may include a chest X-ray if pulmonary edema is suspected. Fetal investigations include fetal biometry surveillance as well as CTG monitoring. Fetal biometry may detect chronic uterine placental insufficiency resulting in intrauterine growth restriction, and CTG may detect acute uterine placental insufficiency resulting in fetal distress. Prompt diagnosis and risk stratification is paramount in the management of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. In many occasions, these patients may be adequately managed as outpatients, but patients with greater risk profile or with more severe spectrum of disease may benefit from inpatient monitoring and management. The goals of outpatient therapy are blood pressure control and constant monitoring of maternal and fetal well-being. The goals of inpatient therapy are stabilization and resuscitation of the patient, seizure management, blood pressure control, fluid maintenance, and vigilant monitoring of maternal and fetal well-being. The final and most definitive treatment for hypertensive disorders in pregnancy is delivery. A multidisciplinary team should always be involved in the management of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. These include the primary obstetrician, the anesthetist, the midwife, and the nursing staff. Firstly, there should be stabilization and resuscitation of the patient. Efforts should be made to abort any ongoing seizures and medications rendered to acutely control the elevated blood pressure. A judicious fluid regime should be commenced. The fetus should be monitored at all times via CTG to detect any acute fetal distress. Plans should be made for delivery once the patient is stabilized. Seizure abortion and prevention. Diazepam, either rectal or intravenous, or intravenous magnesium sulfate, when administered promptly, help to abort and prevent eclamptic seizures. The airway should be secured via intubation by the anesthetic team. Seizure safety should be practiced. The patient should be laid down on a flat surface, any restrictive items removed, any surrounding dangerous items cleared, and most importantly, nothing should be placed in the patient's oral cavity. Blood pressure control may be achieved via a range of oral or intravenous antihypertensive agents. Certain groups of antihypertensives are not safe for usage in pregnancy and should be avoided. These are beta blockers, diuretics, and ACE inhibitors. For acute control of elevated blood pressures, agents such as IV labetalol, IV hydralazine, and short-acting peroral nifedipine may be considered. For chronic control of elevated blood pressures, agents such as peroral labetalol, peroral methyldopa, long-acting peroral nifedipine may be considered. There should be conscientious maternal and fetal monitoring at all times. Maternal monitoring includes a daily pre-eclampsia chart where the blood pressures are monitored every hour, which includes the systolic, diastolic, and mean arterial pressures. Daily urine albumin should also be performed. Serial hematological investigations should be performed to assess the progress and guide management. These include full blood count, renal panel, liver function tests, coagulation profile, and uric acid. Fetal monitoring includes fetal biophysical profile, and this may be monitored with serial growth scans to detect and monitor intrauterine growth retardation and the amniotic fluid index. Cardiotocographs may help detect any acute fetal distress. The definitive treatment of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy is delivery. The optimal time to delivery is usually a 37-week gestation, unless there is evidence of maternal or fetal deterioration. The risk-benefit ratio should be weighed before any decision is made to expedite delivery. Intrapartum steroids is beneficial if the fetus has to be delivered prematurely. The mode of delivery may be either vaginal or via C-section. The latter, usually if there is an indication of acute delivery or other contraindications to vaginal delivery. The postpartum period is an often neglected but equally crucial component of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. There is a 25% risk of development of an eclamptic fit within 24 to 48 hours after delivery. Intravenous magnesium sulfate should be continued till 24 to 48 hours after delivery if a patient has severe preeclampsia. The antihypertensive regime should be reassessed after delivery and titrated down or even tailed off if possible. Methyldopa should be switched to other agents due to the potential to cause maternal postnatal depression. Upon discharge, the patient should be reviewed within a week for monitoring of blood pressure. Counseling and advice should be rendered about the risks of recurrence in subsequent pregnancies.